is an Unspoiled Network podcast.
This is Unspoiled, covering the Dresden Files, Book 3, Grave Peril, Chapters 22, 23, and 24. In these chapters, Harry tries to lasso a demon. Doesn't quite work out, though. Welcome to Unspoiled. I'm a rolling thunder, power and rain. I'm coming now like a hurricane. My lightning's flashing across the sky. You're only young, but you're gonna die. I won't take no prisoners. Once we're too late, nobody's putting up a fight. I got the feeling I'm gonna take you to hell. I'm gonna get ya, say it, get ya. Oh, hell's bells. What are you laughing at?
Nothing. Just tries to lasso a demon. And I was like, you know what? I guess that's pretty much what happened, isn't it?
Yep. Yep, but he misses that demon and he lassos a tree. And then he's like, no, it's fine. I was trying to get the tree. Whatever. Welcome to the show, everyone. I'm Natasha.
I'm Rashawn.
And I have read all of the Dresden Files books. And remember I was telling you about how there are some small books of like short stories and whatnot that people recommend reading? I've told you about this, right?
Yes.
So I went to Jim Butcher's website because I figured that he probably had like a suggested list for what order to read things in. And it turns out he has written a lot of short stories in this universe for anthologies and stuff. The anthology that we did a Song of Ice and Fire podcast on a couple years ago in Dangerous Women has a Jim Butcher story in it, which I didn't even realize. So there is a lot out there, and I'm wondering how many people listening to this realize that and have read those, because they're in, there has to be, it looked like there was at least six different short stories in different anthologies, and I think there were more than that.
With but, just, like, peripheral characters that we don't get a lot of in the books, he just gives, like, fleshes them out?
It's not clear to me if it's peripheral characters or if it's just peripheral storylines, and it's still Dresden that's, like, the center of attention. I would imagine Dangerous Women is about a woman character, but it might be, like, because even on the side, like, side jobs and working with Bigfoot in those books, it's... all, none of it is from anybody's perspective but Harry's, except for one. There's one that's from somebody else's that you haven't met yet. But, so yeah, I'm just really interested in that, and I had no idea, and I haven't read those. So, guys, if you've read them and, you know, you feel like they're worthwhile, let me know. If not, I might, you know, eventually encourage us doing some of those for patrons or something. But,
oh, that's a fun idea.
You know. So what did you think of these three chapters?
Well, I laughed a lot at that last chapter. Because I didn't get the joke of Harry's costume until it was really laid out.
Oh, okay.
And so I thought that was really, it doesn't happen to the end of the chapter, but I thought that was pretty fucking good.
He's such a smart ass.
But the other two, the 22 is really, I thought was really kind of really sad, actually.
Yeah, definitely.
When he goes and finds Michael and there's this tense moment before Michael answers about how the kid is doing, and the kid's not doing great. Mm-hmm. And Michael's just kind of like really at a low point. But yeah, they were good.
Yeah, this is it's something that I forget exactly how it's handled, but the fact that it starts off every time with Harry being like, all right, so which one's the brand new carpenter? All cheery?
Mm-hmm.
With just no, you know.
Yeah.
Just kills me.
Yeah, and you would think that he wouldn't be so cheery because look what they just, like, walked from, like, got away from, you know. But I thought maybe it was like a forced cheer.
Yeah.
You know? But Michael just seems like he's not even here. He's just, you know, so overcome with the reality that he might lose his son. Mm-hmm. And then Dresden has to be like, well, we kind of got to go.
Yeah.
And he doesn't want to go anywhere. And Dresden really has to be like, well, you know, if we don't do this thing, it's going to be bad for everybody, including the newest addition to your family. And I was like, God, that's kind of shitty. I mean, I get you need him, but goddamn.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and then a second later, he's like, great job, Harry. Jerk those fucking strings like a puppeteer.
Yeah.
And I was like, yeah, at least you have the grace to know that you're being an asshole.
Yeah.
I guess
what we get. That's all we're going to get. There's a doctor, Dr. Simmons, too, which for some reason in my mind she's black. I don't know if that's real. But he says something about her dark skin or her warm skin or something. And I was just like, okay, she's black. And she is fucking trying to take care of Harry. And then she realizes he's not actually injured.
Yeah.
And she's so disgusted with him.
Oh, you're right. It says her hair going gray in sharp contrast to her rich, dark skin. Yeah, you're right.
And she's so fucking over him. Like, she's basically like, get the fuck out of my face. And she knows who he is.
Mm-hmm.
She knows Wizard anyway. And they don't really come back to that about how she knows exactly.
Yeah. I love that he's have you heard anything good? And she just goes, not really.
Yeah. And the best he could do is like, well, I am in the phone book. So maybe that's how she knows. But I feel like that's not how she knows.
Nope, probably not.
Yeah, and it turns out that his head injury was healed by Leah, which I was thinking, oh, that's great. But turns out it's not great.
Yeah. What did you think of this, like, you know, kind of perspective on her doing something like that?
So he says to us that her being able to do that signifies like an increase in her power, and that now she has power in like his realm.
Mm-hmm.
So if she can do that, I feel like she probably can cross over.
Mm-hmm.
If that's a thing she wants to do. I don't know if that's what she wants to do, but
now, what do you mean by crossover?
Like, she can exist on our human plane or whatever. Like, I thought she was stuck there in the never.
Because she was in the graveyard with him.
But was that really like, why? I was thinking that was kind of a weird limbo kind of thing.
Because of it being in the graveyard?
Maybe. I think maybe I misread it. But, so I don't know why this is bad. He says it's bad. And he says it's because it shows that she has more power. But I don't know. I think I'm missing something with the significance of this.
For those following along, he says, if you think I should have been happy about getting a nasty cut closed up, then you probably don't realize the implications. Working magic directly on a human body is difficult. It's very difficult. Conjuring up forces like my shield or elemental manifestations like fire or wind is a snap compared to the complexity and power required to change someone's hair a different color or to cause the cells on either side of an injury to fuse back together, closing it. The healed cut was a message for me. My godmother had power over me on Earth now too, as well as in the Never Never. I'd made a bargain with one of the Fae and broken it. That gave her power over me, which she demonstrated aptly by the way she'd wrought such a powerful and complex working on me, and I'd never even felt it happening. So it seems more like she's able to manifest in our world anyway, if she really needs to, but that her power is diminished usually when she's here.
Okay.
But because of him breaking faith with her, she's able to do things to him that she would never have been able to accomplish before he fucked her over, basically.
That's an interesting way for a broken pact to work.
Right.
It's
very motivating.
Yeah, right? Like, if there's a reason why you don't want... It's like the fucking the promise that Snape makes with Narcissa.
Oh, with Draco's mom, Narcissa, right? Yeah.
Like, if you break it, I think for that, it's like if you break it, you die, right?
Yes.
But, so this is like, if you break it, I have the ability to kill you.
Basically, yeah.
Either way, it's like you said, it's a great motivation for keeping your promises. And yet, Harry broke it anyway.
Mm-hmm.
And he seems surprised that she has this power, but he understands exactly how she's gotten it. You know,
yeah, it seems more like he's been so busy that he hasn't really given much thought to it until he realizes.
Yeah. So he says before that, like he says later, I mean, that as long as he stayed in our world, in the real world, you know, she didn't have any advantage over him. But now that's all done.
Yeah, it's different now.
Yeah. This is a bad time for things to be different.
Yeah, right? Yeah, that's a good way to say that. So he's wiping up in the bathroom and trying to, you know, get himself together. And Stallings comes in. And he's got the notebook.
Kravos's notebook.
Mm-hmm.
And he's reluctant to give it to Harry.
Yeah.
And he's also really cagey. Something is going on. Well, they talk about Murph first because that's important. And she's still out. And the doctors really don't know what's going on because, you know, how could they?
Mm-hmm.
And then it gets to the part about the book. And Stallings is kind of like, if I give you this thing, it has to be gone. Mm-hmm. It can never come back. Right? Like, promise me.
Yeah, he makes Harry promise 3 times.
Mm-hmm.
And finally, Harry's like, yes, okay, I promise.
And he says something about internal affairs is back, you know, snooping around, but won't really tell us anything else or tell Harry anything else.
Yep.
So I don't know, like, what's going on with that.
Yeah, I really like that Harry is, like, he's always the one to not tell people shit. And whenever he's on the receiving end of this kind of treatment, I always gloat a little bit. Because how does it feel, Harry? How does it feel, huh? That's what you get.
Yeah. Yeah, he thinks he's the only important person who can't divulge all the details.
Mm-hmm.
But doesn't like that shoe on the other foot, does he?
So then he goes into talk to Michael, who's standing outside the nursery. And this is when Harry finds out that things went badly with Charity, that they think she got hit in the stomach.
Yeah. They had to do an emergency C-section, and they don't know if she can even have kids again, like any more children, which is like, Jesus.
Yeah.
Yeah. I feel like for that couple, that's like the worst news they could get.
Yeah, they are a be fruitful and multiply kind of couple.
They would have their own show on TLC if they were like...
Oh, my God. Except they don't, like... You know, invite enough personal drama into their lives for them to, like, be appealing.
Fair. Yeah, they don't have any...
Unless you count demons.
Well, okay, there you go. There's a show.
Yeah.
TLC would have that shit right up.
They would.
They really would.
Rashawn, maybe we want to find a friend that's, you know... interested in getting pregnant multiple times and have a little chat. Sit down. So Harry finally is like, all right, that's it. We need to fucking take care of this. And Michael's like, I'm not leaving here. And Harry just lays it all out and is like, is there anything you can do staying here? Is there somebody watching your children? Then let's go. I forgot to mention that actually too last episode, because Michael's just about to be like, oh, we need somebody to watch over the kids. And there's a knock at the door, and it's Father Forthill, whose tire popped a flat.
Right, that's right.
Right outside their house, basically.
That's right. There's God work mysterious ways for Michael.
And I like the fact that Harry's like, well, who's going to take care of the kids? And as he says it, there's the knock, and Michael just sort of looks at Harry like, what do you think? Do you think I'm an amateur? Do you think I don't have something in place to just for such an occasion?
Michael's like, I got a guy. Don't worry about it.
Right, yeah.
So this is when Harry has sort of an epiphany about what it is they're fighting.
Mm-hmm.
because he realizes that whatever it is should have come right after him. But this is Michael, I think, and he's feeling guilty because Charity ended up getting injured and all this ruckus.
Mm-hmm.
And then Dresden realizes that this ghost feels like it is not just doing dangerous stuff, but it seems really direct, like it has an agenda almost.
Well, and also that it's understanding the relationships between people.
Yeah, like
in a way that it shouldn't.
It understands that it can hurt Michael by hurting Charity.
Mm-hmm.
And that demons shouldn't understand, like, feelings of sacrifice and love and, you know, familial bond, I guess.
Right.
They only understand, like, power and greed and lust and, I guess, all the evil urges.
Right.
Quote unquote.
Yeah, demons are way too self-absorbed to understand why somebody would care about their family, in other words.
Yeah.
So the fact that they have chosen to go after Michael by going after his wife just doesn't feel like something a demon would do. It would come right after everybody that had a hand in hurting it.
Yeah,
right. It would kill them, and it would be done with it.
Right.
So, yeah, this leads to them realizing that it is a cat's paw somehow, and they need to figure out who it is that's wielding the weapon, I think. Is
Can I tell you, I was not familiar with that turn of phrase, a cat's paw.
Oh,
and
no?
I feel like it's been used before, and I meant to say something the last time I saw it. Yeah, I don't think I've ever heard that before. I wasn't even sure. I mean, I got from the context of the you know, what's being said here. I understood what it meant. But I was just like, oh, I've never heard that before. A cat's paw?
Yeah.
Like, what? First thing I thought of was a rabbit's foot. And I was like, wait, no, that's not what they mean.
Yeah, I'm trying to think, like, when the first time I would have heard that was. But I can't remember. I used to read a lot of Nancy Drew. And I wonder if it was in that. Because they use, like, weird antiquated language sometimes. But
it's such a strange phrase to me. I can't spell.
I think it's like they're playing with you, like a cat, you know, cat and mouse, like playing. But yeah, it is weird. And I recently heard it on Poirot because I was rewatching all of those, and he says it at one point.
That sounds like a place you'd hear it.
Right, yeah. But yeah, that's a good point. I wonder what the origin of that is. I'm sure somebody listening is like, I could tell you that. Go ahead, tell us that.
We're getting ready. Find out.
Right.
It's a phrase derived from the La Fontaine's fable, The Monkey and the Cat, referring to a person used unwittingly or unwillingly by another to accomplish the other's own purpose.
Oh.
So with that definition, if Butcher means it in the true sense of the word, the phrase, then the demon doesn't even know it's being used.
Interesting.
That is interesting.
Yeah, so that changes things a little bit.
It does. Okay.
The more you know. So... Then they also have a little heart-to-heart about Harry being involved with the Lenanshi, Leah. Yeah. And Harry explains that she helped him get out of a tight spot when his old master tried to kill him.
Yeah, because Michael is just like, this lady is... Not only is she trying to kill us now, but she just doesn't seem like a good sort for you to be... you know, fraternizing with.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of like, you know, why are you even messing around with someone like this or something like this?
Right.
And that's when Harry tells us. And Harry's story doesn't make it sound any better.
No, right? Like, you know, basically, she purposely took advantage because I was in a spot where it was my life or make a deal. Mm-hmm. And she knew that, and she was fine with it.
Yeah. She's a crossroads demon.
Right, yeah. And when he says, like, I didn't choose her, Michael's like, well, who did? And he says, my mom.
This is, gets really interesting. We don't get nearly enough information because they're on it and then they're off.
Mm-hmm.
That's quite a little bombshell to drop.
Yeah. So we already had Harry bringing up a demon who was like, oh, yeah, your mom. What's up? And then we have this weird thing with Harry being like, yeah, my mom picked her. So yeah. Harry's mom was a complex woman.
Yeah.
We're discovering. And
doesn't he suggest they might have even been friends? I don't even know if friends is the right word, but...
allies.
Allies, yeah, that's better. But allies against what, though? Mm-hmm. I don't know yet.
So, yeah, Harry's basically like, she's part of my life, but I don't know that there's anything that I'm going to be able to do to get rid of her, because this is kind of just how it is. And he assures Michael that they're going to get Amorakius back. Because there's, like, Leah just cannot help but make deals. And if Harry offers her something good enough, she's going to take it. Which I think is almost insulting in that he thinks she's going to fall for his shit again when he's already bailed on two deals.
Right.
You know?
That is the only thing I could think that he could offer her would be himself, because that's what she wants.
Mm-hmm.
That's the only thing I could think she could, that they could offer her, make her give the sword back to Michael, is if Harry offered up himself. But then Michael is having this sort of crisis because he's like, well, maybe my time with the sword is over.
Oh my God. <You know? laughs> I love that. Maybe. And Harry's like, oh my God, can we not do this right the fuck now? This is not the time.
And he's just like, well, my family, you know, maybe it's time for me to be a full-time dad. Put all this slaying aside.
This slaying.
Harry is like, no, no, and no. Get your shit together, man.
So they head out of there and go to Harry's to do some magic to track down whoever this is.
Which Michael does not like. I mean, yeah.
Yeah.
He's not a fan of the magic. And he knows what Harry's deal is. He knows what Harry does. But he's still kind of like, well, I don't want to watch it. I don't want to be down there when you're doing it. I feel like he's all probably like, it's the devil's work. And that seems like a really silly thing to think, considering what they do together.
Right.
But, you know, Michael is who he is, I guess.
Yeah, I'm not sure if he would say that it was actually the devil's work so much like God being involved, it leaves a little bit too much open space for the devil to sneak in there somewhere.
Yeah, I don't think that he would say it's the, you know, the devil's work, like literally, but just that it is in the, like you said, it's the, in the absence of God, you know. But he goes out with Harry on these missions and uses, and knows Harry uses this magic to fight whatever it is they're fighting. So it's a weird, I feel like Michael is really riding a very fine line here.
Yeah, you know, it's like, oh, just, well, I'm not doing it, so it's, you know, just fine.
Exactly, like just this shy of being a hypocrite a little bit, you know? Like, I'm not going to let you, what is the word I'm looking for? I'm not going to let you... I won't be sullied by it personally.
Right.
So I'm not doing anything wrong, but I'll totally like just pretend you're not doing the thing you're doing. And then I'll go out with you and let you use the fruits of what I'm thinking are ill-gotten gains.
Right.
It seems to be a gray area.
Yeah, I think that's fair.
Oh my God. When they get this phone call, listen.
Oh my God. I forgot about this, and when I was listening to the audiobook, the way that James Marsters does this just cracks me up.
I was screaming. It was so funny. I was yelling at him to fucking take a message.
Oh my God. She sounds very upset. Like, what do you think it was about?
I don't know. Maybe there's some, to get back to the beginning of the book, maybe there's just some ghost activity happening somewhere. I mean, we haven't seen Susan in a while now. That's true. Last we saw her, I remember she wanted some information from Harry, and he didn't give her everything she wanted.
Right.
Which is pretty normal for their relationship. So I can only assume that she's been doing her own work, digging around. And maybe she found something. Either another disturbance somewhere, or maybe another victim of a weird possession. I know we're not saying these are traditional possessions, but, you know, she's definitely come across something that she happened on just in her snooping ways.
So this ritual, Harry takes some things that are of significance to the people that this demon thing has gone after. And he puts them in the circle and sends out a spell to summon the demon. And when he thinks about the demon, which is what motivates the spell, is his thinking about the effects that it has had and connecting that to a being out there. The spell just kind of searches randomly and doesn't seem to be directed toward any specific person, which is the opposite of what it's supposed to do. Like, the whole deal is supposed to be that it goes straight for whoever it is and grabs them. And it's not until he starts to think about the fear and the effects of this spell, the nightmare, as he keeps calling it, that it concentrates on something, finally. And it starts to fight him.
Yeah, he has to tap into the fear he has of it to really get it focused. And when he was when he describes the spell at first, when it's just kind of like, you know, just moseying around, I was thinking, oh, is this part of the deal with him not having his... Because did we ever come back to him losing some of his power? Did I forget something?
No, you haven't forgotten anything.
That's still a thing that's happened, right? So he's not at 100% full strength.
Correct.
So I was like, oh, the spell's not working the way it's supposed to because he's not, you know, he's not running at 100%. But then he's able to get the spell to work the way he needs it to. So I was like, oh, maybe that's not a thing anymore.
I mean, he's able to get the spell to work, but he can't hold the thing.
I just figured that was because the thing was so fucking strong. But you're right. He doesn't. So maybe it is...
It might be both.
Yeah, you're right, though. But yeah, my assumption was just that it was that powerful. But that would make sense because he's weakened, so. Because he really has to fight this fucking thing. I mean, it's like a... All I can think now is like the fucking rodeo because you said he lassos a demon. So thanks for that.
That's funny. He's like getting started on this spell and fucking Michael's already like, are you done? He's like, holy shit, Michael, I've barely started. And Michael's like, well, listen, can you do it or not? Because if you can't, there's only 45 minutes till sundown. So I've got to get going. And Harry's like, if you don't shut up, I swear to God, I'm going to murder you. And Michael just kind of mutters to himself about patience and turning the other cheek. It finally walks away. Oh, I love it. So yeah, then Harry gets started, finally grabs a hold of the thing. It doesn't fully materialize in the circle, so he can't get a good look at it and figure out what it is, but he does get a vibe off of the person controlling it. He can feel them somewhere in the background, and even though he doesn't see who it is, later on, he's really confident that if he runs into that person again, he's going to know.
Yeah.
And he also, like, strikes at it and manages to draw blood a little bit, hurt it, enough that it doesn't come after him immediately as the sun goes down, the way that it might have otherwise. So it's not an entire success, but he manages to do all that and he binds it to him. so that it cannot hurt anybody except for him.
Yeah.
Which Michael's not really thrilled about.
Yeah, Michael's not a big fan of this plan. He's talking to it when they're really struggling, and he corrects its grammar.
Yes.
because it says something like, I will hunt thy friends. And he's like, no, what does he say?
It's I will hunt and eat thy heart.
Yeah, I will tear out thy heart. And he's like, it's thine.
Yep.
So I enjoyed that.
I've told you about how I've been thinking about getting that tattoo, right?
Which one?
The unkindly, it goes by the name of Tramp Stamp to many people, at the lower back. That's just an asterisk and then the word your.
Oh, that's right.
And
yeah.
It's such a fucking snotty thing, but I really kind of want it.
Do you want it there, though? That's a great tattoo. Why do you want it there?
Because it's such a dumb place to get it.
But no one will ever see it.
Yeah, they will. I can show them if I feel like it, but people won't see it unless I say they can see it.
Aww.
I like having control over whether people can see my tattoos, but, you know. That's because I'm a control freak. I have a weird thing where I need to be in complete control at all times. Is that bad?
You should get that shit right on the inside of your wrist, just right there.
Across my forehead. I'll get it on my throat.
Nice.
Like it's a prison tattoo.
Right. Grammar life.
They called her the grammar Nazi inside. Oh,
he's not
dear.
A that grammar life, yo.
Okay. So he then tells Michael, so yeah, I bound this thing to me. This is all great. It's gravy. Now we're going to a party. And they, next chapter, are in front of Bianca's place where they were invited to a soiree that Harry turned down initially.
He sure did.
But he's decided that this is basically the who's who of creepsters and people of power in Chicago. And that whoever has the power to do something like this is almost definitely going to be here.
And he should be able to pick up on who it is, because he's pretty sure he's going to recognize that feeling once he gets close enough to the power. I did not realize it was a masquerade ball.
Yes.
Until he says it. I don't remember if that was on the invitation or not.
I can't
remember,
to be honest.
When we found out that
she
was having this ball, I really can't remember.
Yeah.
But also, he didn't RSVP to his party. Which
I think that might be part of it, is that he thinks, people don't think I'm going to be there.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to be able to catch them easier, because they're just going to have their guard down on expecting me to show up.
I'm just saying it's low class.
It's definitely shady, yeah.
RSVP too.
Mm-hmm.
It's, but he does, and this thing with this girl in this pedo costume, we're not even going to talk about it because we talk about it every episode. But I just want you guys to know that I saw it and I had feelings about it.
So the one thing I can say about this is that there is a paragraph ahead of that describing a man. It's not
the same. There is.
Because the word scrumptious isn't used. But she is described as being maybe 19 years old.
Yeah, because Michael's is like, come on, dude.
Yep.
Fucking pick your jaw off the floor. Roll your tongue back in your mouth, please. Have some dignity. But you're right. He does say something about the guy having the body. Because he's only wearing a loincloth.
Yeah. And he's like, how does it end? He says, the only other thing he had on was a loincloth of some soft white cloth. He had the body for it. Muscle, but not too much of it. Good set of shoulders, and the pale skin wasn't darkened anywhere by hair. Hell's bells, I noticed how good he looked. So, you know, something.
Yeah.
But
yeah, this is like the first time he's described a male like this. Mm-hmm. So he must have been really fucking hot.
And Harry is a little put off by this guy because he acts really friendly right away.
Right.
Which always puts Harry's guard up. And he also knows who Harry is immediately.
I was going to say, he does the thing, oh, you must be Harry Dresden, which no one likes that. No one likes anyone to be like, oh, you must be so-and-so. Because why? Why must I be so-and-so? You know? It immediately puts you in that, what have you heard, you know, please.
And it puts you at a disadvantage where you don't know their name. Mm-hmm. So you have somebody standing here that you know nothing about who apparently knows some shit about you, and not only that. Again, yeah, control freak.
It's definitely a power imbalance. Mm-hmm. You know, they've got an advantage. But Harry perseveres. He moves past that moment. Mm-hmm. I think because the guy just doesn't react to Harry's gruffness at all.
Yeah. Yeah, he seems like, really good-natured, and it's just unclear whether or not it's for real.
Mm-hmm. Harry is like, yeah, I'm Harry Dresden. Who the fuck are you? And the guy doesn't even, like, bat an eye about it. He's like, I'm so-and-so of the such-and-such.
Yep. Yeah, where is that? Let's see, when he introduces himself. Who the hell are you? Of course, you probably know very little of the intricacies of the court. My name is Thomas of House Raith of the White Court. White Court, I said. Three vampire courts, Michael supplied. Black, red, and white. I knew that. Michael shrugged one shoulder. Sorry. Thomas smiled. Well, only two, for all practical purposes. The Black Court has fallen on hard times of late, the poor darlings.
Oh, the shade.
His tone of voice suggested muted glee rather than pity.
Yeah, so now I'm immediately curious about the Black Court. Like, of the three that are mentioned, that's the one I want to know about. Because I figure if they have fallen on dark times, that means they're probably desperate.
That's true. That's fair. Yeah. So he asks Harry if he's aware of the etiquette. And Harry says no, as long as it doesn't have anything to do with drinking blood. And Thomas says no, not formally. But he says this is a red court function and we're outsiders. So we'll be presented to the company and they'll have the chance to come meet us. And afterwards, we'll be presented to Bianca herself, and she, in turn, will give us a gift. And Harry's like, a gift? And Thomas says, she's hosting the party. Of course she'll be giving gifts. It's only civilized. I eyed him. I wasn't used to vampires being so chatty. Why are you being so helpful? He laid his fingers upon his chest, lifting his eyebrows in a perfectly executed, who, me? Expression. Why, Mr. Dresden, why should I not help you? You're a vampire. So I am, he said, but I'm afraid I'm not a terribly good one. He gave me a sunny smile and said, of course I could also be lying. Yeah, Thomas is a real mystery. I like when I first read this, I kind of fell in love with him a little bit because of the shade and everything. But I was also like, you can't be cool. Like, there's no way that you're going to do something, right? Like, there's no way. But I also kind of wanted him. Right. But I didn't want him to be terrible, too, because I just thought he was so much fun.
There's a common thing that you see with depictions of vampires, and I think it has something to do with the idea that they're immortal or at least very, very, very old. Mm-hmm. That they have this higher sense of civility, right? Mm-hmm. And the humans are actually savages.
Right, right.
And Thomas just is, you know, that reeks of, you know, he just is all in that. So in my mind, that's how that whole conversation is just him being very haughty and very just, you know, mm-hmm. poor little humans don't know anything about anything. And I could get upset at your insult or your rudeness, but it's so beneath me, I'm not even going to get upset about it.
Yeah, I have better things to do. This is a waste of time.
Yeah. And he also seems to be having fun with the fact that Harry really doesn't know what the fuck to make of him. He seems to be enjoying that.
Right. Yeah. That's definitely a big part of the... It's just the power play of just being like, I know who you are, and I'm going to throw you off by being nothing like what you expected.
Yeah, yeah. And I'm going to say right to your face, oh, I could be lying, though. And mm-hmm. you just wouldn't know it, would you?
So then we to jump ahead a bit. Ladies and gentlemen of the court, I'm pleased to present Harry Dresden, Wizard of the White Council, and guest. I lowered my hands and the voices fell completely silent. From either side of the throne opposite, a pair of spotlights glared at me. I shrugged my shoulders to get my cape to fall into place correctly, tattered red lining flashing against the black cotton exterior. The collar of the thing came up high on either side of my face. The spot glared off the painted gold plastic medallion I wore at my throat. The worn powder blue tux beneath it would have made an appearance at someone's prom in the 70s. The servants at the party had better tuxes than I did. I made sure to smile so they could see the cheap plastic fangs. I suppose the spotlight must have bleached my face out to ghostly whiteness, especially with the white clown makeup I had on. The fake blood drooling out of the corners of my mouth would be standing out bright red against it. I lifted a white gloved hand and said, slurring a little through the fangs, "Hi! How y'all doing?" My words rang out on deathly silence from below. Yeah. Yeah.
This motherfucker dressed up like Dracula on Halloween. To a fucking vampire ball. I just... that was so beautiful to read. I laughed so fucking hard.
Thomas stared around at the courtyard with undisguised glee, then flashed me a smile and a thumbs up. I love that so much. Oh, God.
I wanted to be like two thumbs up. Yes. You know, like that guy, like the buddy Jesus from Dogma. Where he's
yes.
That's what I wanted to be. Oh, it's so good. And then Michael was just like, dude.
Yeah. He says, I think you've peeved them off. Peeved? Yeah. Come on, how bad could that be? Peeved. From the courtyard below came several distinctive sounds. A few hisses. The rasp of steel as several someones drew knives. Or maybe swords. The nervous click-clack of someone with a semi-automatic working the slide. Michael shrugged in his cloak, and I sensed more than saw him put his hand on the hilt of one of his knives. I think we're about to find out.
Michael's like, I can't believe you came dressed as a vampire. And Harry's like, but it's a cheesy vampire. Oh, not just a vampire. Oh my God, it's so good.
He's such a child.
I'm hoping that even though the crowd is clearly tensed and unamused, right? Mm-hmm. I'm hoping that there's not a big melee, and instead Bianca maybe comes out and calms everybody down and addresses Harry. Because I don't want a big fight. I want information. And if a big fight breaks out, I'm not going to learn anything, really.
That's fair.
You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So that's what I'm hoping happens.
Yeah, this is something you're thinking more clearly than Harry was, I think.
Yeah, oh my God. Like, what, dude? Why? Like, what do you want? I mean, is it like going somewhere in blackface? Like, is it?
I mean, it sort of feels like they're reacting that way, right?
You know, it's like, I have to believe that is super, super offensive. You know. It's just rude. It's just rude. So between not RSVPing and showing up dressed like a cheesy vampire, Harry is not getting invited to shit else.
Right, yeah. Yeah, he's it's sort of like if I invited somebody to a party, And they were like, you know, came dressed up in like Cheetos stained sweatsuit and had a microphone. And they were like, I'm a podcaster. I'd be like, you can go. Just, you know, any, just don't imitate your host's deal in an insulting way.
I feel like that's sort of basic.
Mm-hmm. You would think.
So, I don't know. It's clear that he's instigating, so maybe he wants to start something.
That's but true.
But to what end? I would think he would be better served by doing what it sounded like he was saying to Michael, which is, I can get to this party, everybody who's anybody is going to be there, and I can get an idea who's who. Mm-hmm. And who's doing what. But if it just turns into everybody trying to kill him, I mean, maybe that, because they're enraged, their power will be stronger, and maybe that'll help him pick up on who it is, but I don't know.
Or I don't know. Maybe Harry just can't resist poking at people because he's a child. You know,
that is also a thing, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, but come on, Michael has lost his sword right now. He's not running at 100%. This is not a great time to be poking various bears.
Mm-hmm.
Various bears, because there's more than one bear there.
There is more. It sounds like a child's book.
I know, right?
That's there's my more favorite. Than one bear there.
The bear who had no hair. do you know that one?
No.
Oh, the bear who had no hair? Turned out he wasn't a bear at all.
That's what was my... he?
He
what
was
kind of charlatan?
He was just a guy.
What?
Let me tell you.
Oh, that's kind of fucked up.
Okay, all right. Really quick, I have to tell you. So this is something that I had never heard of it. And Steve knew it somehow. It was like a childhood something. I had no idea what it was. And he used to say it all the time. And I just thought it was funny. And then one night, we were watching cable. And we were high as fuck. And someone made a cartoon of it in the 70s. And it came on. And I have never, to this day, I have never laughed harder. It was the craziest thing I had ever seen. It's Fuzzy Wuzzy was a bear. Fuzzy Wuzzy had no hair.
Mm-hmm. I know that. Fuzzy
wasn't Fuzzy Wuzzy. He was just a man. I'm sending it to you right
That's
now.
That's how it ends? He wasn't fuzzy. He was just a man?
It's longer than that. I mean, hang on. I'm about to send this to you right now. This isn't the original one that I saw and cracked up at, because that shit is from like 70. Oh, no, I'm not sending it to you. This is terrible. That is some kind of weird Disney remake or something. I don't know what's going on with that. But anyway, the moral of the story is that Fuzzy was not a bear.
I never knew that when they say he wasn't fuzzy, it meant that he wasn't even a bear. I mean,
right, let me see.
That's now just traumatizing.
I'm like, well, am I wrong? I don't think I'm wrong. I need something with the fucking lyrics. Oh, this is a tongue twister. This isn't right. Guys, I'm sorry I'm holding the podcast, but YouTube is failing me because they're giving me a bunch of shit that I didn't ask for.
Because, yeah, that's what I'm thinking. Like, I'd always heard it as a tongue twister.
Really?
Mm-hmm. Oh. Fuzzy Wuzzy was a bear. Fuzzy Wuzzy had no hair. Fuzzy Wuzzy wasn't Fuzzy Wuzzy.
Yeah, that's what keeps popping up, but there's more to it than that.
I don't know. You were high as fuck. Are you sure you remember clearly?
Oh, come on. I was high as fuck.
I would never stop laughing, though, if you had this bizarre, like high dream of it actually was just a dude. Like, how creepy a thing to think of.
I have a witness, though. He was also high, though, but...
Yeah, he doesn't count.
He really doesn't. Oh, my God. After we're done, I'm going to keep looking until I find
it. I mean, he might have been the one that made the joke that, like, oh, it's just a dude. And then it just, like, lodged itself in your brain. that's what happened.
That's so disturbing. What is the name of the people who...
what just happened?
I found an album called... Fuzzy Felt Folk, a collection of rare, delightful folk oddities for strange adults. So I'm going to get into that as soon as me and you are done.
Oh, my God.
That's going down.
I'm really glad I'm taking a Facebook break right now. Oh, God. For strange adults. Accurate. Oh, man.
That's the actual title of the record. Oh, I can't wait. I need to write this up, so.
All right, so I just am going to say hi to new patrons, and then we're pretty much going to be wrapping up. So, patrons, what's going on? Welcome to the Unspoiled Family. If you're interested in being part of the Unspoiled Family, you can go to patreon.com/unspoiled and pledge whatever you think is fair and, you know, to get access to whatever tier of reward you would like. And if you are $10 and up, make sure to double check that you put your mailing address in with your profile so that I can send you your postcard for the month. This month's is going to be the unicorn that says, don't shame people, judge them silently as God intended, which is a quote from Rashawn from the Harry Potter podcast.
Desmond posted his today. It looks great.
What's that?
Yeah, Desmond posted his.
He had a shirt. He got a t-shirt made, yeah. Because it is available right now on TeePublic. Ding! But yeah, so if you are a patron, you're going to get a postcard, and I want to send you one, so be sure to have your address there. And new patrons this month, or this week, are Daniel Keogh, Nathaniel Catanio, Christine Y., John Tansick, Joshua Broussard, Melly B., Carrie Keenum, Ken Poklatar, Anton Belaine, hi Anton,
hey, oh, shit.
And Tommy. So welcome to all of you guys. Thank you so much for pledging. I love you the most. If you're $3 and up, you get a monthly cocktail hour that I do live and drink at, and people come and hang out with me and chat with me, and those are really fun. I just did one last weekend, so July is over, but there will be one coming up in August. I believe it's going to be the second week in August, but the calendar that I posted in the patrons group should have it on there. And yeah, I'm just like really enjoying getting a little bit more time now that I've changed how some of my schedule works to be able to like lean into some of that extra stuff. So I'm thinking I might reopen my Snapchat and make that a little bit more of a thing soon for the podcast to say hi to people. What's up? I have to learn how to use it though, because Snapchat's wicked confusing to me. I'm just old enough that I don't get it. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah, I don't. I mean,
I'm sure once somebody shows it to me, I will start to get it, but it's just weirdly set up enough that I'm like, really? That's what I press to get that? That doesn't look like that button at all. What? So, guys, forgive me, but you should keep an eye out for Unspoiled Podcast Snapchat. Coming soon to a podcast Snapchat near you. I don't know where I was going with that. Anyway. And no matter what level you pledge at, you will get access to the Game of Thrones episodes, which I am doing with Rashawn and Miles. We recorded, and I've just posted earlier today, the episode for episode 2, Stormborn, which was a lot of fun. I had a good time. Episode itself wasn't great, but our episode was great. I'm flailing, guys. I'm tired. I'm sorry. All right, everybody. Well, I think that's everything. Do you have anything you want to add?
Nope.
No? You sure?
Mm-mm.
Okay. All right, everybody. Thank you again so much for listening. Make sure to leave a review on iTunes if you've been enjoying the show. And we will see you next week with 3 more chapters. Toodaloo, motherfuckers.
Bye, guys.
Yeah!
was an Unspoiled Network podcast.